Well, it looks like the days of the almighty dollar could be coming to an end. As the currency weakens, countries are looking for alternatives, and it looks like the euro also has a bleak future. Economists are pointing to a weakening U.S. and EU economy, while emerging economies are growing. China, for example, is expected to trump the U.S. GDP in just a few years. And just last week at the BRICS summit in India, the five most rapidly growing countries agreed to ditch the dollar and trade using their own currency. So has the dollar seen its day? And is the euro going down with it? Well, Gerald Salenti, publisher of the Trends Journal and director of the Trends Research Institute, joins me now to dig deeper into all of this. Welcome, Gerald. Nice to see you. So what are some signs today that the dollar is weakening?
Well, look at the price of gas. Remember, these are petrodollars. And what do we have gas prices at? Now we're seeing Brent crude at, what, $125 a barrel. And what they're really doing is they're creating the same scenario that they did to blow up the bubble that ended with the real estate crisis and the financial credit crisis. So go back to 2000 and the NASDAQ crashed. What did they do? Well, after 9/11, Alan Greenspan began to lower interest rates to 46-year lows. Of course, the nation was in a recession, and they used that as an excuse. So they're doing the same exact thing now, only but a little differently, in the sense that now the Federal Reserve has said that interest rates are going to remain low essentially throughout 2014. And what are they doing? Well, now it's a different kind of bubble. So now consumers are again going into debt, losing their savings and borrowing more, building up more credit card debt. Student loans, again, more debt. What's fueling the equity markets? It's simple, low interest rates. So they're creating another bubble, and the Europeans are doing the same thing with their central bank. By dumping what? About 1.3 trillion euros into the banking system since the end of last year and loaning it out to banks at virtually no interest rates. So, of course, the BRICS want to come up with another currency because they know they're getting shafted.
Now, the U.S. has a very big debt problem, as you just mentioned, but there is also this crisis in the eurozone. Which currency do you think is in more trouble?
I think right now the eurozone is in much deeper trouble. But again, it's relative. It's which one is going to go first. And Liz, when you read the quote by Dilma Rousseff, the president of Brazil, at the BRIC meeting recently, she said, quote, "It will not be overcome simply through measures of austerity, the crisis that started in the developed world, or fiscal consolidations and depreciation of labor costs, let alone through quantitative easing policies that have triggered what can only be described as a monetary tsunami, has led to a currency war, and have introduced new and perverse forms of protectionism around the world." What she's saying is very important. Go back to the crash of 1929. What was it? The crash, a depression, as you have now in a lot of the world, a deep recession, followed by currency wars, followed by trade wars, followed by World War II. The same scenario since the Panic of 08 is playing itself out again.
Now, we are seeing the BRICS just last week. They want to take matters into their own hands and say, hey, we don't need to use the dollar. We want to trade in our own currency. But if there is, Gerald, this shift away from the dollar as a world reserve currency, what then would replace it?
Well, again, probably a basket of currencies. And oddly enough, Zolnick, the head of the World Bank, who about 2 years ago came out and said that there should be a basket of currencies, of which gold should be part of it, has also come out in favor of the BRIC nations deciding that they want another finance vehicle. He said, quote, "I'm enough of an economist that I'm not a monopolist." So something new is going to be created. And it's very important that the dollar became the reserve currency after World War II with the Bretton Woods Agreement. And at that time, when you go back, The United States was the only game in town. Europe was destroyed. There was no Russia in the business. China, it was behind, you know, the Iron Curtain that they had, the Yellow Curtain over there. You had no India. Brazil? What was Brazil doing? This is a whole new world. It's beyond a post-World War II world. It's a 21st century world.
And the times definitely are changing, especially with the U.S. Now not as powerful as it once was in terms of the economy, at least. And we see the BRICS nations, their economies are growing at a very rapid rate. So, Gerald, how soon, if we do see this shift to a different world reserve currency, when would that happen?
I would expect it to happen after the presidential election. They're going to do everything they can to try to keep this going and to try to soothe any kind of ripples coming from around the world. But, you know, this is much bigger than just a dollar crisis. It's really the decline of Empire America in so many different ways, whether it's waging its losing wars overseas and draining its treasury, whether it's the mountains of debt that they're piling up, or whether the declines in virtually every OECD-led industry, whether it's quality of life, health care, the list goes on and on. So what we're seeing is the decline of America and the building up of really a 21st century economy. I think it's going to happen after the elections.
Now, ultimately, what would this mean? Because, you know, economists are talking about what the implications of this could be, but why should the average U.S. citizen care if the dollar is no longer the world reserve currency? What are the implications for everyday Americans?
It's a lower standard of living. It continues to decline, and the price of everything costs more. The United States, of course, like, you know, the Eurozone, has the leverage to print its own money. So the more that they print, the cheaper, the less the value. So what this means to Americans is a continued decline of quality of life. And I don't say that as just a throwaway phrase. By all indices, for example, median household income is below 1999 levels. When you see the decline of the decline of real wages over the last quarter, it's one after another. So that's what it means.
And speaking of quality of life, Gerald, what kind of plays into that as well is gas prices.
Exactly. That's what I was saying. It's petrodollars. And again, this came about only in the 1970s. And that they're going to start pulling off that, as we're already starting to be seen. So you look at the price of everything. Oh, and by the way, how foolish of me to talk and you to talk about oil prices, because the Federal Reserve does not include food and fuel into our core index. So we just have to throw that away because, after all, we don't have to eat or use fuel. What deranged mind would really include that into a core index? The books are being cooked. The numbers are a lot worse than they are. And all the Federal Reserve is doing, I believe, is pumping this up to make it so that it looks like there's a recovery up until Election Day.
All right, scary stuff. But Gerald, thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your views with us. That was Gerald Celente, publisher at the Trends Journal and director of the Trends Research Institute.